should the Senate be a back door into the cabinet? Well, by way of introduction, let me say that this question is not whether the senators can be admitted into the cabinet. To that question, the answer is obvious. They can be. The question is, what should be their qualification? Now, let's look at the convention in the United Kingdom. The principles by which the Prime Minister appoints senators into the cabinet are derived from the UK. Like us, the United Kingdom has a convention that a government minister must be a member of either the House of Commons, like our Devon Riot, or the House of Lords, like our Senate. If the Prime Minister wishes to appoint a minister who's not a sitting MP, his only option, like in Malaysia, is to first appoint such a candidate into the House of Lords. It's called ennobling, because it's the House of Lords, so you're ennobled. However, those who are appointed into the cabinet from the House of Lords were and are of the highest calibre. Now take for example the late Lord Young of Graffham. David Young was an entrepreneur, a businessman. He wasn't a politician. Thatcher ennobled him as a member of the House of Lords and made him a minister. He was one of Thatcher's most trusted cabinet ministers. During the second half of her time as Prime Minister, David Young executed her policies on employment, privatization, and business. It was a very difficult time, if you recall. Thatcher personally credited him for her third successive election victory of 1987. She said her success was because of Lord Young's policies as Minister for Employment. In 1984, the Financial Times quoted Thatcher as saying, "Other people come to me with their problems. David Young comes to me with his achievements." Another example in the UK was Zach Goldsmith. In 2019, he lost the elections. Boris Johnson ennobled him, made him a member of the House of Lords, and appointed Goldsmith as the Minister for the Environment. There are other examples in the UK, and they show quite consistently that the upper house ministers were of very high calibre. The question is, what should be the qualification of a Malaysian senator? It's not clear on what basis senators are appointed. Although there is a semblance of procedure for the election of a senator within the constitution, this is far from satisfactory. In the past, it has led to abuse, and the time is now ripe for reformation. Now, you will realize the duration of a senator's term under Article 45, Clause 3 of the Constitution is 3 years. Since he may be appointed twice, a senator's tenure can last as long as 6 years. They usually do. His or her appointment is not affected by any dissolution of Parliament before elections. Now, there are two classes of senators, as you might have realized. The Senate has a total of 70 senators. 44 are known as the King's Senators. 4 from that group of 44 are appointed for the Federal Territories. They are all appointed by the King. The remaining 26 are indirectly appointed by the states. What was the original intent, you think, behind the Senate and the appointment of senators? Well, this can be seen from the 1957 Reid Commission's recommendations. The Commission's recommendations, which were, you will note, accepted by both the UK government and the then Malayan representatives, including the Royal Highnesses the rulers, form the basis of the current senatorial structure to this very day. The Commission said that the power of the upper house, the Senate, will be revising and delaying powers. The Commission continued, "We do not recommend that the Senate should be wholly elected because we think that it would be valuable to have in the Senate persons who might be unwilling to stand for election." but who have given distinguished service, for the Federation, not to his party, or one who possesses special qualifications. That's in paragraph 62, if you'll notice. Now, this is the real precursor to Article 45, Clause 2, which speaks about qualifications. Note the operative words, special qualification. There are two main principles or planks of a leader. The correct principle to be applied uniformly is that every senatorial candidate must satisfy the high benchmarks set out in the two main principles. The first is a qualitative question for all leaders. It speaks of what qualities a leader should possess. These are five, these being, number one, loyalty to the rule of law. That makes sense, doesn't it? Selfless devotion, says the second, to the nation and its people. The third is a well-trained mind. The fourth is that person must be possessed of recognized ability. Number five, mature experience. The second is Article 45, Clause 2. That mandates that senators should be from amongst persons who have rendered distinguished public service or have achieved distinction in six areas of, number one, the professions, number two, commerce, number three, industry, number four, agriculture, number five, cultural activities, or number six, social services. Note the use of the past tense in the phrase have rendered, have achieved distinction. So, if a candidate is to be appointed as a senator, because he's a mere doctor or a mere lawyer, he doesn't fulfill the requirements of Article 45, Clause 2. He must have achieved distinction in his professional life. Long before they are eligible to be considered for the appointment as senators, the potential candidates must have far surpassed the qualities of any normal citizen. If, before they were appointed, our current senators or future senators had achieved no such merit, then these senators have no business sitting in the Dewan Negara. I want to speak about the abuse of the Senate and departure from the original purpose. The previous regimes have, over decades, cast aside the Senate's constitutional role. The upper house was to serve as a check and balance mechanism. Its members were to vote with their conscience against the possible abuses of power by the lower house or the government. This was defeated because previous regimes have used the Senate as a poor standard backdoor for ministerial appointments. Although that was allowed under Article 43, Clause 2 for ministers, under Article 43, Capital A, Clause 1 for deputy ministers, and Article 43, Capital B, Clause 1 for parliamentary secretaries in the Constitution, when it is used as a sole reservoir for defeated election candidates of poor quality or as political rewards, it defeats the purpose of the second chamber in a bicameral parliament. Bicameral means two houses. Most of its appointments and appointees have not achieved the requisite level of skill, let alone any distinction in public service or in the professions for the Federation. Now, there is a third category, those who represent racial minorities or who are capable of representing the interests of Aborigines. The third category, as I said, comprises of senators who represent racial minorities or the interest of Aborigines. Therefore, leaders from the different Aboriginal groups or racial minorities should have been made senators. Has this been done? Well, you know the answer. If so, have these Aboriginal senators or minority members rendered distinguished service to their respective interest groups? What if an entire racial minority rejects the appointed senator, particularly if he has been a losing candidate in an election held before his or her appointment? If so, those who have taken their seat under this third category have to go, and such persons should never be appointed. So there is a need to establish a senatorial appointments commission. Now, lamentably, There is not a single express criterion for the state nominees in this procedure. Now, this leads to abuse. Whether senators should be elected by popular vote from the electorate is not the purpose of this article. The Raid Commission actually speaks against it, and that's a debate for another day. But within the current constitutional fabric, senators are appointed partly by indirect election and partly by the king's appointment. Because there are no rules governing how senators are appointed, all sorts of people are ascending to Senate seats. This is bad for the country and must be stopped. So in conclusion, might I say that the only way any improvement can be brought is by public participation in the selection process of senators. This could be achieved by the establishment of a Senate Appointment Commission under federal law, for example, an act called the Senate Appointment Act. The commissioners of that body must be those described in the two main characteristics as described above. There must be representatives from each state, from the various fields and the professions. The commission should, having studied the antecedents of the candidates, recommend two lists, sending the first to the Prime Minister and to the King, and second from the state list. If this procedure is followed, the vetting processes over senatorial appointments will not only be thorough, but all of this will be shared between different stakeholders, and there'll be a greater transparency. In this way, there can be some level of quality control over who enters the Senate and who leads the nation and who ends up in the cabinet. The time is ripe for reformation. What will you do? What will the Prime Minister do? Well, we'll wait and see. Have a good day, and thank you for watching this video. Goodbye.